Next up, we have Kalyani Bhatia, who is head of business innovation Americas, UK, Ireland for Swift. Kalyani is going to take us through the state of ISO 20022 adoption.
Thank you so much. This is my first in-person event, so I'm relearning how to do all of these deliveries. I'm used to doing it in the comforts of my own home with my own lighting, so we'll get through this today. My name is Kalyani Bhatia. I am the head of business innovations at Swift. I've been there for a little over a year now. I came from Deutsche Bank, spent 18 years at Deutsche Bank here in New York as well. My team is essentially a group of pre-sales market experts that cover things like GPI value-added services, ISO 20022, transaction management, my standards, and we cover the Americas and UK, Ireland regions. So I believe I am between you and lunch, so I probably have a really tough segment today. There's a lot of information I have to share with you. I won't have time for Q&A during the session, but I'm happy to stay through lunch, and if you have any questions, please, I'm happy to take those with you. So let's get started. All right, so I really wanted to cover three major sections today. I wanted to speak about the evolution of Swift with its strategy and its platform. We're going to spend some time looking at some of the details of the ISO 20022 adoption, and I wanted to give you kind of a progress report on how we're helping our community with the adoption. I have a report card on the community, and we'll talk a little bit about what is the call to the action for the community, next steps, where can you find out more. So as a refresher, cross-border payment MT messages categories 1, 2, and 9s are being decommissioned as of November 2025. If you remember, it was in SIBO's 2018 in Sydney where Swift originally announced that we were going to move to ISO 20022 with cross-border payments in November of this year, and then we were going to have a four-year coexistence period. The community came back and said, hey, that's a lot of change for us to consume right now. Can we delay? And then, of course, we hit COVID, and it just ended up being a further delay. So we responded, Swift responded back in April of last year with a revised approach and timeline and a new strategy that has been approved by our board in November 2020, focusing on delivering instant and frictionless payments account to account anywhere in the world underpinned by ISO 20022 rich data, moving away from point to point messaging and instead moving to transaction management and orchestration. So why did we think we needed to change our strategy? What was going on in the industry? And it's really these five themes that you see on this slide. The first one being upstream disruption. It's caused by new platforms or other services trying to address friction in transactions. And if they're successful, we'll change how Swift transactions get generated. Most importantly, we see direct competition. Clients' needs are changing, and there's little tolerance for friction or unpredictability. Fintechs and other disruptors fill that particularly need in the front end by a greater user experience. Compliance continues to occupy resource and senior management attention. Mandatory changes, also driven by regulators and MIs and Swift, translates to more time and resources and costs for banks. Finally, new tech being rapidly adopted, particularly by new entrants. It can lead to widespread disruption, but also brings opportunity to do things differently. So let's look at a little bit at our strategy, and it's really to deliver payments faster, better, smarter. It's these four key components that you see on the screen. So in payments, we're gonna help the community strengthen in existing markets while opening new opportunities for SMCs and customer segments. We want to make international payments as simple as domestic ones. We will also intensify our focus on securities. The aim is to support all asset types, not just tokenized assets, and to help the industry make processes like reconciliation and reporting more efficient and less complex. In the next few years, we'll evolve our platform based on the state-of-the-art technology, end-to-end transaction management, and rich data. Our platform will essentially mutualize services, which is essentially take all the things that the individual banks are building and paying for themselves, like pre-validation, fraud detection, sanction screening, and bring those into the center for the full community to use. And we'll maintain full transaction data at the center. We'll talk a little bit about this on another slide. But we're mediating between users of different protocols and formats to ensure that no data is lost, corrupted, or overwritten in the process. Finally, the new foundation will enable smoother migrations by acting as a buffer between intermediaries, like the adoption of ISO 20002 for payments. We'll address the differing needs of financial institutions, allowing them to migrate at their own speed. We'll bridge formats and provide central mapping and translation rules so that the value of richer data can be captured by the whole community. If I were to summarize our ambition, it's really to build the future rails on which all financial transactions could be running on tomorrow. So this next slide really highlights, I know we talked about innovation a lot on the last panel, but this is really the innovation that SWIFT has continued to do and move with the market needs of the community. So back in the 1970s, we knit the financial economy ecosystem together with the FinMT standard as we moved away from telexes. This was very traditional correspondent banking, point to point, and very much like the postman. This is what I like to call the MT. It's we pass the message, but we don't actually look inside. Then in 2017, we introduced SWIFT GPI, which introduced secure messaging, payment tracking, and service levels. So you now had a UETR, a code that actually linked all the messages within the same transaction. You got the GPI tracker, which then you can see where a payment actually is in its transaction lifecycle. And you had various reports to make sure that your payment data quality was up to snuff, as well as making the overall process more efficient and ultimately faster movements of money. Now in November of next year, we'll be moving on to transaction management. We'll be building upon the foundation of GPI, and we will be able to keep that business transaction information in the center to make sure that the data is complete and available to everyone in the community. These next few slides, I've actually given you what you can really see is the world is really all moving in the same direction for ISO 20022 adoption. Many of the payment market infrastructures are already live today. We've got several that are going live next year, the Eurozone, UK, Canada. And by 2025, you're going to see 85% of high-value payments volumes, and around 90% of value will have moved to ISO 20002 payment platforms. At the top of the slide, you're going to see some of the major market infrastructures and their timelines for when they go live. On the bottom, you have the matching CBPR Plus, and we'll talk a little bit about what that is, the ISO 20022 flavor, and the SWIFT deliveries that match up against that. And what I've given you in the next couple of slides, take a look at it when hopefully you'll be able to get the package of these slides. I've given you all of the global market infrastructures, when they'll be starting testing, when they go live, or who has already gone live. So take a look at some of these slides when you get the deck. So we've talked a little bit about why we needed to change. What is the strategy all about that we've adopted? But how are we going to deliver against that? And it's really around these three key pillars. The first one, rich data. It's the ISO 20002. We're moving from MT to MX to ensure the consistency of transactions across the payment chain, and especially the ones that have legs in domestic systems. I have an interesting fact to share with you. So Forrester Consulting did a survey for us last September on cross-border payments and compliance. So as part of that study they did, 96% of respondents said they face data issues with their cross-border payments, incomplete or missing data, multiple formats and channels, or poor quality data. Richer and smarter data will enable us to significantly reduce the remaining friction of both compliance and operational issues, remove the need for repetitive processing, and fully harness the benefits of automation. Also adding APIs. So APIs will be available as a channel for customers in order to seamlessly access payment data through the upgraded platform. So you'll have Fin, MX, and APIs all available in November. We're seeing a large demand by many of our clients for tech solutions that are lighter, that save them time and money. So how are we going to deliver instant and frictionless payments? We're not starting from scratch. We're not building a brand new system. We are gradually evolving our very successful GPI tracking framework, measuring SLAs, and speed around processing payments. We'll do this on the basis on the concept of active transaction management. We'll bring those common services into the center for use by the community. By bringing together the data in the common services, we aim to significantly improve end-to-end efficiency, reduce costs, while bringing new business value to end customers with faster, more reliable transactions and better, richer data. So let's talk a little bit about the ISO 20022 adoption itself. So again, the community has decided to move to ISO 20022 for cross-border payments, and we'll make this a reality. The first step is next year in November. There will now be a coexistence period of 3 years until 2025, when those MT categories 1, 2s, and 9s are set to be decommissioned. The goal of ISO 20022 is to achieve end-to-end rich structured data throughout the entire payment chain. There's wide adoption across many of the market infrastructures, whether they're RTGSs, instant payments, or ACH networks. So how is SWIFT going to support the community in this adoption? So any bank will be able to send a CBPR Plus message to their correspondents, and that will be done on the Fin Plus many-to-many interact-based network. We'll talk a little bit about that in an upcoming slide. We'll also have inflow translation available for banks to be able to send ISO 20022 messages to any of their correspondents, regardless of their readiness. Banks will be able to send messages via MT, MX, or API. And finally, through transaction management, we'll keep that central data in the center so everyone has access to the full rich data, avoid any loss of data in an event a bank sends an MT message during the coexistence period. So this slide actually shows you the traditional MT-103 message on the left and what it's going to look like in an ISO message on the right. And this is how the remittance information is going to get mapped into it. And essentially what you see is ISO structured data is going to give you a lot more data that is of higher accuracy than what you receive today. You'll get more remittance details, more party detail data. You will get better data-driven insights on the purpose and context of your payments. Today, banks have little insights into the business purpose of a payment, but with ISO data, you could potentially extract spending habits or patterns, which will help you develop relevant, valuable, and personalized new services for customers. We are all looking for reductions in false positives from compliance checks, no more time spent on wasted investigations where key data is missing from the transaction. We all want increased efficiency. Incomplete or misleading payments can lead to a payment being marked or flagged as problematic, which results in further manual review and remediation. In an ISO world, data is entered in right on the first time, resulting in fewer failed payments, less manual interventions, less delay, more efficiency, cheaper cost, with a higher overall customer experience. So what is CBPR Plus? So there are many flavors of ISO 20022, and this is the one that the industry has chosen to go for cross-border payments. There's also a working group of the payment experts across the banking community all over the world, which create the market practice guidance, the actual message definitions, the translation rules between the ISO MX formats and the MT message specifications, and they test them to make sure that they are fit for purpose. One more time, category 1, 2, and 9s are going to retire decommissioned in 2025. And they'll be replaced by the CBPR Plus ISO messages and your APIs based on ISO specifications starting in next year. Fin Plus. So let's talk a little bit about Fin Plus. Next year with the platform, in order to be able to send or receive ISO 20022 messages, you must subscribe to the Fin Plus service. This is an existing service. It's based on Interact, Store and Forward, and it And it's actually being used today for our security space where we have ISO SRD2 messages already there. And when it's basically an XML representation, so that's where that MX comes from instead of the MT in Swift kind of speak. So where can you find all of the information on CBPR Plus? You're going to find it on the My Standards portal. The link is here. All of these are going to be active links that I've given you in this deck. And I wanted to spend some time on some other key areas that are highlighted, which are really probably tiny for you, by the red arrows on here. But what you can find on this page is the first arrow is pointing to the user handbook. And this is really, it's used to document and explain a variety of ISO 20022 payment-related topics, as well as provide practical use cases to ensure a common understanding of how to use the ISO 20022 messages within the payment industry. It's updated on a quarterly basis as we get updates from that CBPR Plus user group. The next one is documentation. This is where you're going to see the usage guidelines for CBPR Plus. The readiness portal. It's an online test portal that's XML, where you can actually send in XML messages and test them, and it'll validate it against the CBPR Plus usage guidelines. MT-MX equivalence tables. So this is an inventory of all of your MT messages, what the corresponding ISO 20022 MX equivalence will be, when they will be available on FinPlus, and when they will be decommissioned. And then finally, the translation portal. This is an online visualization tool that you're going to see the translation logic. So the logic that's been defined by the working group between how to get from an MT to an MX message and vice versa, MX to MT. So if you send in one format, you'll be able to see how it's translated and drops it into the next format. Let's talk a little about testing. So there's going to be lots of different ways customers can test on this journey. So during the implementation phase, customers will be working on standards testing. They'll be using the readiness and translation portals I just spoke about to validate the structure of their CBPR Plus ISO messages. This is done standalone. You don't have to be on the FinPlus service. Customers are also going to be working on their SIT unit and integration testing. During the testing phase, so this is when you're on the FinPlus service, you can do something called loopback testing. And this is when you actually send a CBPR Plus message to yourself, and then you can watch how you're sending and receiving messages in your own shop. Next, customers are going to validate functional integration by simulating exchanges using the Swift Test Sparring Partner. And this is where the application creates a fictitious counterparty, and you can send messages back and forth. You'll also have a catalog of predefined test cases and test data available with this service. Finally, we suggest customers to validate business and technical interoperability by exchanging real-life traffic with counterparties of your choice. This is what we call community testing. So that's kind of all the things that are going on in the testing phase. Going live. So this doesn't have to be a big bang. We're seeing lots and lots of customers roll ISO 20022 adoption out in waves. They're doing it based on BIX, currencies, traffic patterns, or combination of all three. So lots of different ways that you can think about it, and you should really start to think about it soon in your project planning. Prior to actual go live, we do expect customers or suggest that they do some dress rehearsals. This is to perform one last test across your business, your technical, your operational readiness within your community. And then make sure you have some tight monitoring in place the weekend of go live and the several days after that when you're in a live exchange. So that kind of summarizes lots of different types of testings that you can be doing as part of the ISO 20022 engagement with Swift. And on the next slide, I actually have the timelines of when a lot of that is available to you. And we'll talk about each one. But a lot of it is available today. So what's available today? You have the CBPR Plus 2.0 usage guidelines available and ready to test with in the readiness and the translation portals. You can already subscribe to the FinPlus service. Loopback testing, so sending messages to yourself, that's also available. The test sparring partner, where you're simulating between a simulated counterparty, that's also available. And finally, the inflow translation will be available for testing by the full community in November later this year. So lots of foundational items for you to kind of kick things off and start working with some of these messages. So, what are we doing to help the community get ready? So towards the end of last year, the beginning of this year, we were talking to a lot of customers around the new strategy, the new platform, the upgraded platform. And what we were finding out is when we talked to our bigger customers, when they were talking to their own institutions internally and talking to their customers, there was still a lot of confusion and not a lot of clarity about what people should be doing. So what we did is we put together a program. We launched a program over the summer with a cross-functional team focused on customer readiness and really focusing on our smaller and medium clients. So we broke it out into these three phases, and it's awareness, which kind of is running now. I would say it's towards the tail end. Phase two is implementation. We'll kick that off after Sibos next week. And then you have phase three. This is going to be a two-year program that goes along with the journey of all of our customers through next year, and that's really testing and go live. And what we really did is we're monitoring 8,200 different BICs globally that were impacted by ISO 20022. We're trying to simplify the messaging and really focus in on different needs of our customers based on their architectures of how they've implemented the infrastructure. And we're talking directly to our biggest customers, all of the service bureaus, and we've had over 250 bilateral conversations on what people need to worry about and get ready for next year. For our smaller to medium customers, we ran this in a campaign style. We've run webinars for the last 2.5 months. We ran 3 a week, different languages, different time zones, to make sure that we were getting the messages across. So across that, we essentially had 91 webinars that ran. We've had 9,000 attendees for all of the webinars, and we're seeing about 4,000 BICs actually download some of the free materials, documentation, or attend a Swift Smart module for some training. So the second phase is kicking off after Sibos in a couple of weeks. The invites for those webinars have already gone out. If you need to pass those webinars around, or you didn't get an invite and you want to attend, I'll highlight, there's another link in the deck where it'll take you directly to the page to see the webinars. But these webinars are now focused on implementation. So they're talking about how is my business operations, how am I going to be impacted by these new types of flows? And then we have a set of more technical webinars focused on individual architectures. So are you using a service bureau? Are you using one of Swift's Lite 2 products, cloud products? So based on the architecture of customers, we have different tailored technical webinars that will run starting after Sibos through the end of the year. So I have a bit of a report card on the community and how we're doing so far. And I was going to do a poll, but maybe we'll just do a quick in the room show of hands. Is this the first time? Who's hearing ISO 20022 details for the first time? Excellent. Well, I see a couple hands in there. So for the ones that this is the first time, this is why we do these events. My team, I'm happy to go out. If you've got organizations that you need us to come talk about what's happening in the industry with ISO 20022, happy to support. That's why we do it. So let me showcase where we are with the community today. So Swift had put an ambition for ourselves that we wanted to get 90% of our community aware of what's happening, what do they need to do by the end of the year. And you're going to see a couple categories here of informed and aware. Aware means that they attended one of those webinars in phase one, they've had a discussion with their account manager or someone from my team, and they know what they need to do. Some of them may have completed an ISO questionnaire that we had available. Some of them downloaded the connectivity guidance paper, which I'll talk a little bit about, or they listened to a phase one recording. Informed means that they've done some work, they've taken some training, they've downloaded some documentation, but we really wanted to make sure they were getting some of the key messages about what they needed to do and what was really coming down into next year. So you can already see that we already had reached that 90% goal just after the first phase of webinars that we ran. And so we said, all right, by the end of the year, now let's try to get 100% of our community aware, because this is super, super critical. This is about business continuity. This is about banks being able to do their business when the platform is available next year. And actually, these figures are a bit stale. I got a new dashboard on Friday, so we're at about 94% awareness globally. And how that breaks down for AMUK, so the Americas and UK, Ireland, I'm at 94% for the region. LATAM is 95%, North America 92%, UKI 96%. So some really good progress, but a little bit more work to do from a SWIFT standpoint. So I do have some other stats for you looking at the full kind of customer journey. I'm showing 25% of the global community has signed up for the Fin Plus pilot service. So that's where you're going to be able to exchange those MX messages. And they're actually testing on the readiness portals and my standards. For AMUKI, that's 72%. So this region is really, really doing some great work on getting themselves ready and prepared. And I also am seeing 1% of the full community sending CBPR Plus messages on the Fin Plus pilot environment. So actually doing some exchanges and sending some of those on the environment as well. So what is the call to action? So I know there was a lot of information today. What we're asking is that you make your interfaces, make sure they're ready. Whether you're on SWIFT interfaces, you're using a service bureau, you're using a different application vendor, they all have access, they're all tied into SWIFT, they're getting the same documentation that we're giving our customers. We're trying to make sure everybody has their interfaces upgraded and ready for next year. Make sure you can actually consume MX and multi-formatted messages on Fin Plus. You also have to sign up for the Fin Plus service. And really important to understand the impact of your operations and compliance obligations. Next, there's lots of terrific free resources available, whether it's webinars, documentation, recordings. There are, we'll talk about it on the next slide, but there's tons of great free resources at your fingertips on some of the pages I'll put in the next couple of slides. And finally, talk to your counterparties and your correspondents. These are really good resources to hear about their lessons learned on their adoption journeys and to make sure that we're all kind of on this journey together. And don't think that you're alone in this. So we're here to support you. Find me on LinkedIn. You can send me an email, kalyani.bhatia@swift.com. Any questions, I'm happy to have any of my team come out, sit with your organization. There's a lot of material. They'll step you through. They'll try to help you understand how to use all of the resources that you have available. So if there was one link that I wanted you to remember, bookmark when you get the slides, it's this one. And this is a new one on the Knowledge Center. It's all about the platform. And as we come up with new content, it's dropped on this page. And there's a couple of things I wanted to share with you that's on this page. So there is the platform connectivity guidance paper. And this is something I briefly touched upon earlier. The first version was published in April. The next one is coming up right after Sibos. And this tells you what to expect when you interact with the platform. It tells you your connectivity options. It will tell you the messages that are in scope for the first release and give you the timelines for all the SWIFT interfaces when they're able to consume those new MX and multi-format messages. So really, really must-read document. The other one is the Getting Started Guide, and this is a new piece of collateral that we've put out there, and probably my most favorite piece that SWIFT has ever come up with. It really starts, it's a personalized journey, it's a click-through document, so it will tell you, you know, am I impacted by ISO 20022? How can I budget for a project? It's very checklist-based, and what I really like about it is that it integrates all of the different links. We have a ton of links and information at SWIFT. We have a ton of webinars, sometimes they're hard to find. And as you go through some of these topics, it will take you, there are links directly into those, whether it's a SWIFT Smart training, documentation, and so that it happens to be one of my favorite pieces that we've put together. It really just is kind of one-stop shop of everything that's ISO related. One more slide here. These, again, all of these are active links. We've kind of talked about a lot of this. The point of this is just to say there's lots of free information out on the SWIFT network for you to get to. There are ISO invites newsletters that come out bi-monthly. There are programs for your vendors and partners if you want to make sure that they are complying to the ISO 20022 and they are upgrading their back-end systems. We have partnered with programs that are helping our vendors as well. So lots and lots of information. And really, one last slide, more links for you guys. These are the kind of top 10 greatest ISO 20022 key links for you that I would, that are in this slide deck as well for you to take advantage of. Last thing before I let you go, Cybos is happening next week. Please take advantage of all the great content. Encourage you, your colleagues, to register. This is hopefully our last virtual one. Next year we'll be in Amsterdam, but that means that this year it's free, free, free. Everyone gets to go. We have over 11,000 registrants so far and look forward to engaging with all of you next week. Thank you.